United Airlines flies first with 100% sustainable fuel. Australia ramps up to be almost all digital by 2025. Apple can soon send you tools and instructions on how to fix your own Apple gear and how to add your vaccination cards to your digital wallet. All that and more next on The Computer Doctor Show.
You're listening to The Computer Doctor Show, your source for technology subjects affecting your business and personal life during this new normal. Your host is an award-winning office technician and IT specialist, author, tutor, ethical hacker, and recent winner on localbest.com as the best computer shop in Tucson. Broadcasting live, here's Aaron Moss.
Hello, Tucson and the podcast world and the nerd world. Welcome to the Computer Doctor Show, your headquarters for up-to-date scam awareness, science, and cutting-edge technology talk. This is episode 70. I'm Aaron Moss, your host, and 30 pounds lighter. Thank you so much for tuning in with us every Saturday at 2 p.m. We post all of our shows and bonus content on computerdoctorshow.com. Again, computerdoctorshow.com. Our open lines, 520-790-2040. Feel free to call in any time with your comments and questions and even complaints we can answer. Co-hosting today is Cy from the Cassie Unscrewed Theater.
Hello. Thanks for having me.
All right. It's always great to have you here. And before we go any further, I just want to thank our sponsor, the expert technicians at Perfection Auto Works near Speedway in Craycroft. They have a free 26-point inspection, and I've had my car serviced there myself with that 26-point inspection. Very, very complete, very, very knowledgeable people there that really know how to take care of your cars. Give them a call, 520-323-8650. We have a packed show for you today, so we're going to get straight into our tech news this week. There's been in the news, it's been like a lot of talk about cars going electric by 2030, but it's hard to make an electric airplane. Okay, so you know, the same technologies of having electric cars, I don't think we're going to get there very quickly with having an all-electric airplane, because planes still, they still need that thrust.
Yep, and that, batteries are heavy.
Yeah, yes, exactly. So something's got to give. So this past Wednesday, United Airlines did the next best thing. They came, they became the first in aviation history to fly a passenger flight using 100% sustainable aviation fuel, or SAF. That is, again, sustainable aviation fuel. So they say that this flight will serve as a turning point in the industry's effort to combat climate change. So the question that I had was, what exactly is sustainable aviation fuel? Okay. And it's basically made from garbage. So you know the last part of Back to the Future,
yeah, right? Absolutely.
Where Doc went into the ground. He said, I need fuel. And he started banana peel, beer can in there, right? So apparently, now I would like to know where all of this, how long we've been dealing with sustainable aviation fuel and why we haven't been doing that when did this just pop into the equation and now they're just using it in this flight? So that is apparently what they did this past Wednesday. So 100% of the fuel is made with garbage in one engine. So they had, obviously, you know,
your backup just in case.
Yeah, they had real fuel in one engine, and then they had this garbage fuel, or SAF, sustainable aviation fuel, and in the other engine. So the FAA gave special permission for this flight to prove that there are no operational differences. There was a very interesting Twitter board with lots of comments, and one of them was there was a question that was raised, and the question was, well, which engine was it, the left or the right, that had the sustainable fuel in it? And the answer was, we didn't tell anybody. Mm. That was just an example of how, just like regular jet fuel, that this acts. You can't really tell the difference. That was part of the
whole experiment.
Part of the whole gag, right?
Yeah.
So they're not supposed to know. But no bad reports. They landed safely. So hopefully, maybe there might be some garbage fuel. I would like to turn my garbage into fuel. I would
That'd
like to get rid of my electric bill and just put my garbage into some sort of machine that makes electricity for my house.
That works.
I would love that.
I'll take that.
Also, the Australian government ramps up to be almost all digital by 2025. And so basically, there was this updated government strategy as part of its goal to make Australia one of the top three digital governments in the world by 2025. So just 2 years ago in 2019, the top digital three of these countries included South Korea, Britain, and Colombia. And at the time, 2 years ago, Australia did not even report anything because you have all these countries have to report in to get put onto this list. So the digital government may become a new race that claims to put the needs of the people and businesses first. I've never heard that from a government.
That sounds new and exciting.
Right? Put the needs of the people and businesses first. It means going beyond having people simple online services and investing in cutting-edge technology to provide a personalized experience that is stable, secure, reliable, and ultimately anticipates the needs of every user. So could you imagine a government where your needs are anticipated, okay, and all you have to do is just agree or just sign on and just things just start happening?
It's a beautiful dream.
There are governments that
That can pull it off.
And some I know of one that can, but that's a whole nother discussion. But this report also says that according to the Australian website, all government services will be available digitally. They also hope that it will be easy to access. Therefore, everyone has to be, you know, online of some sort, and also people and business centric and. It's going to have a consistent look and feel. So some of the problems that websites, you know, digital government, some of the problems is a lot of the departments don't talk to each other.
Right.
Okay. You can sign on for a particular service or benefit on this website, but then
it's a whole different process somewhere else.
Yeah. So if you want to apply for another something, around, you have to put out your name, your address. You have to verify. You have to get this note for verification from this other department. They don't talk to each other.
Right.
You become like the...
You're the hub.
You're the communication hub for all of the government services. So governments realize that, and they're trying to make this happen with this change of infrastructure. So the real question is, how does the metaverse actually fit into this? Are you going to be able to go into like a government room in the metaverse, like in goggles, and there's a judge there, and there's the mayor there, and the governor is there?
Wow.
Who knows? Yeah, that'll be very interesting. But there was a very interesting video that we're going to post on our website regarding the story. Just go to computerdoctorshow.com and click episodes and then look for episode 70. And also, Apple can now send you tools and instructions on how to fix your own Apple gear. So this is part of the right to repair movement.
Mm-hmm.
So many of the products and services that are coming into existence now that are being manufactured, they're being made in such a way that they can be user repairable. So it used to be that your laptop could have just had like a little sliding switch to pop up your battery.
Right.
We're probably going to see a return of those, okay, instead of there being screws, okay? Also, your... you know, iPhones that are coming out, because this is a report that the from Apple, the iPhone 12 and the iPhone 13 lineup will be among the first to actually be supported by the self-repair service, and soon to be followed by Mac computers that are featuring the M1 chips. Now, this self-service repair will be made available early in 2022. That's next year. In the United States, and expand to additional countries throughout the rest of the year. And their focus is going to be mostly serviced on service modules. So the most often pieces of hardware that actually need servicing, what do you think?
Keyboards on the Macs.
Okay, keyboards on the Macs. What is the most serviceable?
Oh, the glass itself.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, the glass itself on the phone.
The iPhone display, the battery, and the camera.
Right.
So they're trying to make those three things the most commonly serviced modules, and soon those will probably be user replaceable.
Right.
So that's pretty cool. Also, Apple states self-repair is intended for individual technicians with the knowledge and experience to repair electronic devices. They still recommend going to an authorized repair shop, but there was no mention in the article about guarantees, warranties of the work, or the outcome.
Right.
And they also don't mention if there's any instructional videos in any of these repair procedures. So if you... Unless you're a person that can follow directions verbatim in writing, you know, I don't know who still reads anymore, but, you know, it takes a little bit of concentration.
Absolutely.
Okay. Have you ever tried to put together a bookshelf?
Oh, sure. Absolutely. I've taken apart Macs many a time.
Well, this is obviously doesn't apply to us. We're talking about like normal people. Right? Okay, we're going to take our first midway break, commercial break, with a word from our sponsors. Up next, how to add your vaccine card to your digital wallets, both Apple and Android, and some tech anniversaries for this week. Stay tuned.
We take you to winter 1776.
Message for General Washington.
Yes, Captain.
Oh, hello, sir. Colonel Lee says the Redcoats are encamped just across the river at Trenton, sir.
We need to get the boats down to the Delaware, but the wagons are too noisy. What to do?
Begging the General's pardon, sir, Eustace Emery III. And I can lube those wagon axles so they don't squeak, sir.
Do it, Sergeant Emery.
And so, Washington's army crossed the Delaware.
We can grease your modern car truck axles, change the oil, charge the air conditioning, and do brakes, belts, and hoses on all brands, foreign and domestic. If you want a mechanic that cares about your car and your Thanksgiving, call 323-8650. That's 323-8650 and perfectionautoworks.com.
Computer Doctor of Tucson is the best choice in desktop support in Tucson. They fix error messages, power and boot problems, install of software and hardware, and much more. You can come to them, or they can come to you, or even have a remote support session so they can fix your issues over the phone quickly. Give them a call at 261-5508, 261-5508. Visit them on the web at ComputerDoctorTucson.com. Computer Doctor of Tucson, because technology is great when it works.
Welcome back to the Computer Doctor Show, your source for scam awareness, science, and cutting-edge technology talk. I'm Aaron Moss, your host, along with Cy here, co-hosting from the Unscrewed Theater.
Hello.
All right. Quick announcement here. This is an exclusive on the Computer Doctor Show. I actually looked for this story, and it was no place else, so I'm happy to be the only one reporting on this one. And it was a follow-up report on an earlier story. Theodore Kim had decided to sue Apple for over about $1,300 for the cost of his iPhone 12 back in late October 2021. His phone had failed within the warranty period, and Apple insisted that the phone was tampered with and refused to give any more comment. Mm. So on November 23rd, he won the case in San Francisco, and Apple had to shell out $1,383 plus $95 in court costs. Truly, David did win against Goliath in this case.
Indeed.
Because in other reports, Mr. Kim had said that this is like David versus Goliath. this is like a thing for the little guy. You know, usually people lose. They think that they're going to lose these things,
right?
But then they end up winning some of these things. Ah, so very good. And also hats off to Judge Michelle Tong for judging that case. She did a wonderful job. Before we get into our next segment, Cy, what can you tell us about the Unscrewed Theater?
Well, we've got our usual 7:30 family-friendly shows every Friday and Saturday night, including tonight. And then we coming up starting next weekend, we have a fantastic show on Saturdays and Sundays for two weekends in December called Elves Gone Bad, which is a really fun kid-friendly show featuring Santa and pirates, and the kids who come to the show are invited to join us on stage and be a part of the show. So if you've got kids in your life and they're Santa friendly and Santa inclined, it might be a great show. It's only $5, and it's going to be a lot of fun. And that's at 1 o'clock on Saturdays and Sundays, starting on December 11th.
Okay, and the website again?
Unscrewedtheater.org.
Okay. Now we're going to move on to our next segment, Science and Tech Anniversary. Sci,
absolutely.
What do you have for us?
I've got some science and tech anniversaries, in fact, Aaron. November 30th was, in fact, International Computer Security Day. Mm-hmm. A good day to double-check that your virus things are up to date and so forth, right?
Yes.
December 2nd, 1971, that's 50 years ago, that marked the first successful landing on Mars by the then Soviet Union. The craft was called Mars 3.
All right.
Which means there were two failed attempts that happened before that, I think. December 3rd, 1992, yeah. That's 29 years ago, the first ever text message. In 1992, Neil Papworth, a 22-year-old software programmer from the UK, sent the first ever text message from his computer to his colleague Richard Jarvis, and the text simply said, "Merry Christmas." Of course, emoticons shortly followed. And then a life of emojis. Then December 3rd, 2001, that's 20 years ago, inventor Dean Common unveils the Segway, the self-balancing battery-powered vehicle, on an episode of Good Morning America.
Yeah, how about that? When I first saw the Segway, I thought it was so cool that you can just turn
it
on.
You sort of balance and it just sort of moves.
You're like, but it's not falling over.
Yeah, you know, it's impressive. It's impressive.
Okay. Now, we've come to our final part here about how to add vaccination cards to your digital wallets. Mm-hmm. Now, this whole idea about adding stuff to your digital wallet is, first of all, anybody that's not aware of your digital wallet, if you have a smartphone, whether it's Apple or Android, there's a feature and an app that's by default in there. It's called the wallet. I know on Apple it's called the Apple Wallet. Mm-hmm. I'm not sure exactly what it's called on Android. But it's
same basic features.
Something similar to that. If you know what that is, please call us in and tell us what it is. Because you're dealing with two Apple people here with the Apple phone. So the New York Times reported a few days ago that there are three ways to add your vaccination cards to your smartphone. But it's not so much what type of phone that you have. It's more of where you live.
Right.
Currently, in California, Hawaii, Louisiana, New York, and Virginia can now support what is called smart health cards. And basically what that's part of a health system.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so your state actually has to be part of it. Unfortunately, Arizona is not one of those states where we are. But if you live in California, Hawaii, Louisiana, New York, or Virginia, might want to reach out to your healthcare providers and ask them about the smart health cards. And basically the way, Alabama, Arkansas, Florida, you're not going to be part of this because for some reason your your state has banned this for some reason. So again, Arkansas, Alabama, Florida, this doesn't apply to you. But in these supported systems, what they'll do is they'll give you a QR code or give you some sort of digital file that's probably going to be emailed to you or something, and you may have also some already existing verifiable record stored in your health app. And what that basically means, let's say that you lived in New York and now you moved to Arizona and you already had that app in your phone, it's going to continue to be there,
right?
And it'll still operate while you're still in a non-supported state. So I'm not sure exactly if you already have the existing app, if that can be added in later when you're in a non-supported state, if they would even have access to even implement that in.
Right.
So,
or whether it'd be kept up to date. I think it's more a matter of whether the records end up staying up to date, too.
Right,
yeah.
Because after a few months,
it won't be current.
It won't be current, and some facilities may not let you in to work or to other places if they cannot digitally verify that you've actually received the third dose or whatever dose that you're required in order to keep your job or even to go into a theater or go mm-hmm. to a restaurant or what have you. So basically, it's all up to your state's health system that has to support it. And you also have to have, now, if you have an iPhone, it has to have iOS 15 or higher. And I still have the iPhone 11 Pro Max. My wife and I are hopefully going to be upgrading to the 13 soon.
Okay. I'm in the same boat.
Okay, so we're just waiting for that update to kick in, and hopefully we'll have the 15 or higher. And,
well, I do have 15. I just have an 11.
You're able to get iOS 15 on 11?
Yep.
Okay. Well, then if you can do it, then I should be able
yes,
to
Yes, you
do.
Can. Yes, the 11 will run 15.
Okay. Well.
You just have to go get it.
Okay.
Yep.
But usually there's like a little
I think 15 thing. Was a large, when it's a, when it goes from one big number to another, 14 to 15, it doesn't automatically force it on you or it doesn't make a big deal
okay,
of it.
Okay, you actually have to go in there. Mm. Okay. Hey, maybe you can just do it. You're the iPhone girl, so I'll get your assistance out of it.
Sure.
But anyway, when you receive your test or vaccination, you may be given instructions on how to find your test results, your vaccine status or certificate online. And if you don't have that info, you would, again, want to reach out to the organization or healthcare provider who administered mm-hmm. your test or vaccine. And we're going to be posting the instructions on those on the computerdoctorshow.com. You want to click episodes and then find episode 70 for those instructional things. I did want to make a very interesting remark on the announcements that we were doing earlier today about the 22-year-old software program from the UK mm-hmm. that sent the first ever text message.
Neil Papworth.
Now, he said about the emoticons. So we had mentioned emoticons. So what do you know? Do you remember what was the very first emoticon? The very first.
I would have to imagine it would have been the colon and a parentheses for a smiley face.
That was one of the early ones, but it was not the earliest. The earliest
really?
was actually LOL.
Oh, okay. Okay.
Now, LOL,
you want to call that an emoticon.
Is
all right.
Technically an emoticon, and
sure.
An emoticon is basically just a series of letters and or
symbols yeah.
that look like some sort of picture, you know, or something along those lines. But nowadays we have all these emojis that have been replaced. So now we have the smiley face, the poo, we got the thumbs up.
Sure.
We have, and then there's different skins. And by the way, there's so many, there are ways to get all these emojis. You can buy extra emojis.
Right.
There's like the default emojis that come into your device.
Your phone.
And then there's like extra emojis mm-hmm. that you can buy. You can buy these packages where you have like 1,500 emojis.
Yep.
So do you have your own emoji that has
no.
like your own?
I don't use emojis at all. I'm so old school.
You know what? I find out that you can get further, you know, sometimes when I'm involved in negotiations and if I know the person well enough, sometimes just throwing emojis into the conversation actually makes it go along a little bit better.
Okay. Yeah.
It makes it not as serious.
Sure.
You know, sometimes
sure.
you want to come through as foolish, just a little bit foolish. And then that kind of makes the conversation, you know, go because people can understand your emotions.
It does give context. Yeah, absolutely.
It gives context, and it lightens things up,
sure.
especially if you're contacting somebody for the first time.
Okay? Sure, absolutely.
Because if somebody's asking you a question, you know, where were you on the, you know,
right.
you know, and you know, what were you doing, and who is this, you know, because sometimes I'll get a text message from somebody that I've never heard from, but there's no history. It's just a random person. They're asking me a question. I said, who is this, please? Smiley face.
Right. Should I trust you?
Yeah, exactly. So it's just like one of those things. Anyway, before we wrap up, I just want to thank our sponsor, Perfection Auto Works, again for sponsoring our show. Stop by their location, Speedway in Craycroft, for your free 26-point inspection. Hey, Tom, how about some closing music? If you missed any part of this episode, go to computerdoctorshow.com, click episodes, and find episode 70. My name is Aaron Moss, your host and technology expert. I was co-hosting today.
This episode of the Computer Doctor Show. If you missed any part of this live broadcast, we post all our episodes online at computerdoctorshow.com. Remember, the world is getting more and more tech, and so should you. To stay current with technology, listen to the Computer Doctor Show each week for local and global tech insights. If you have suggestions for a topic on a future show, send us an email at info@computerdoctorshow.com.